And good afternoon to this program, the Center of Excellence on COVID-19 Management program, which is being done by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. So on AIIMS behalf, I'd like to welcome all the state Center of Excellence members from IMA and the other district level public and private health facility doctors and my other colleagues who have logged in. As has been just told to you by Shri Lav Agarwal, we are seeing a huge surge in the number of cases as far as the new variant Omicron is concerned. We also know that this is predominantly a mild illness, and therefore we need to have preparedness for how will we manage the mild illness. The management of mild illness is predominantly going to be home isolation. And therefore it's very important for us to be clear on what do we need and what are the features of home isolation. And that is what we're going to discuss today. Because when we talk of home isolation, the important issue here is who needs home isolation? Who is the person who is positive and fits into the criteria of needing home isolation? The second important issue is what should be the basic arrangement or infrastructure that should be present for home isolation to be available. We can't give home isolation to someone who has one bedroom and there are four people living in that bedroom. So what are the criteria? And those people who cannot have this, we have institutional isolation, which can be COVID care centers. There are also certain hotels which the government has highlighted, which can also be used for this. And the third important thing is that what do we do when we give home isolation to a person in terms of the treatment, in terms of the red flags, and monitoring, so that we know that if anyone is in home isolation and he or she deteriorates, how do we shift this patient to the hospital? And therefore, what is the monitoring that is required, which has to be done by various facilities, both at a district level and at a city level. Along with that, I think it's important that another point that we will discuss today is how CUNY could quickly convert hospitals for COVID care. The last few months we have seen that COVID really came down in our country. We had very few cases, and therefore the focus shifted on non-COVID care. Many facilities which were COVID facilities were converted to non-COVID facilities. But now again, we're seeing a surge in the number of cases, and therefore we need to develop a strategy of how do we reappropriate our beds so that we can again convert facilities which were for COVID, but were doing now non-COVID work back to COVID. And that is also something that we'll discuss. So today we will have a presentation which will be given by Dr. Neeraj Nischal, Additional Professor of Medicine, on mild COVID and home isolation. And then we'll have a discussion. Our panelists are Dr. Anjan Trika, Professor of Anesthesia, Pain Medicine and Critical Care, Dr. Anant Mohan, Professor and Head Department of Pulmonary Critical Care and Sleep Medicine, Professor Aarti Kapil, Professor of Microbiology, Dr. Manish Sinoja, Assistant Professor of Medicine, Dr. Kapil Dev Soni, Additional Professor of Critical and Intensive Care. Then we have clinicians from the State Center of Excellence and officers from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So I welcome you all, and I hope we have a good interactive session. I'll now pass it over to Neeraj to make the presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So I hope slides are visible.
Not currently.
Now, sir?
So we can see your slides.
Okay. How many are you?
So the topic today is mild COVID, home isolation. As sir mentioned earlier, that the moment we thought that we are getting rid of COVID, it has again come with a vengeance. I'm saying vengeance because a lot of people are going to get infected, but how many of them actually require medical attention in hospitalized setting, that is to be seen. So our primary focus at the moment is to provide them care in the comfort of home without compromising any sort of medical willingness of those people, those patients.
Mute kar do.
So basically, this pandemic is with us for almost last two years, and we are learning about this pandemic as of now. So, but definitely we are much wiser than what we were 2 years back. But at the same time, the virus is changing and it's throwing new challenges every day. So I will say all evidence is subject to change. What may be standard of care today may prove to be futile in the future. So whatever we are talking about is in the context of today's evidence. And I declare no conflict of interest. So this pandemic started way back in December 2019. And then this year, again, the baton of the previous strain has been passed to a new variant. And that is expected to cause a lot of chaos and confusion. So this Omicron was described in South Africa initially, and from there it has spread to other parts of the world. That is what we are expecting at the moment. So how is this Omicron different from previous variants? So Omicron variant has more than 50 new mutations, of which more than 30 are in the spike protein, and approximately 15 on the receptor binding domain. So whatever in-vivo model studies have shown that this multiplies twice as fast in upper respiratory tract of the model, and the level in lung tissue is usually less than 1/10 of other variants of this virus. So this is at the moment showing milder symptoms, and the disease progression is not that bad at the moment. But mutation at furin cleavage site is thought to be the reason why it is so highly transmissible. The interaction between ACE2 receptor and receptor binding domain of this Omicron variant is still incompletely understood, and studies are underway for better understanding of this interaction. So this study, this study from Hong Kong has shown that the virus replicates more in bronchus as compared to lung vis-a-vis other variants like Delta. So this could be a good sign that the involvement of lung can be expected to be lower in this particular wave. So the incubation period of Omicron is somewhere around 3 days, which is much lesser than what it was for Delta and Alpha variant. And the doubling time of this particular variant is 1.5 days as compared to 1.9 to 2 days for other variants. So this graph basically merges the waves of the previous waves because of the various variants. And one can easily see that the upstroke of Omicron is much, much earlier and faster as compared to the previous waves of Alpha, Beta and Delta. So we have to be very careful, because the number of cases may increase quite significantly. And even if a very low fraction of patients require admission, then that can be a challenge to our healthcare sector. Luckily, the evidence from the South Africa suggests that if we see we compare it with Delta wave, what we see that the admission rate, the cases, the admission rate and death peaked at the same time, whereas in Omicron wave, which is the current reason for the pandemic to propagate, the cases, admission and death are lagging from each other, which we feel is a good sign. But again, people are thinking that Omicron is a boon because of the Darwinian principle that this virus is trying to survive in the form that it is getting more infectious, but at the same time, it's causing less pathological damage to the host. Because if it causes damage to the host, it cannot survive. So is it a boon? Is Omicron has come as a natural vaccine? What we some people are thinking or are trying to think in that way. So definitely the severe COVID-19 cases typically peak several weeks into the wave. But like I said, even if the cases are not that serious as compared to the previous waves, but sheer number may overpower healthcare resources even if proportion of severe cases is low. So what we have seen is that the disease is milder in young and healthy hosts, in vaccinated cohorts, or those who have previously infected with COVID-19. So is it because of all this reason, or is it because the intrinsic viral properties is such that it's not affecting the host in that severe form which the other variants affected, is something which we will be clear in future. So it's important that we do not lower our guard, at the same time taking all precautions. So how are the symptoms of Omicron different from the other variants? So what we have been seeing, and whatever the data has been published, the sore throat, tiredness, headache, and aches and pains are more severe and more common as compared to Delta waves in patients. And of course, fever, cough, sneezing, running nose, that can happen. So at the moment, there can be mixture of cases of Delta and Omicron. But this is the preliminary data which suggests that Omicron cases have more sore throat, tiredness, headache, and aches and pain. Other interesting symptoms described by patient include chills, night sweats, and burning eyes. So these symptoms may point out towards the Omicron in current context, where the cases of Omicron is increasing with each passing day. So because there is co-circulation of strain at the moment, differentiating just clinically into Delta and Omicron may be difficult, but yes, there can be subtle signs like night sweats, nausea, appetite loss, aches and pains, sore throat that can point towards infection with Omicron. So this was the guidance given in 2020 and 2021. So clinical criteria at the moment will still hold true because the epidemiological thing has more or less because of the community transmission and widespread increase in number of cases is may not be actually workable now. So if somebody has acute onset fever with cough and any of these symptoms, these patients should be a suspect case of COVID-19. So once you have a clinical criteria or contact of probable or confirmed case linked to a COVID-19 cluster, then you have to classify them as a probable case with suspect with chest imaging or suggestive of COVID-19 or recent onset anosmia, egosia, throat pain, chills, and night sweats. Any other identifiable cause of all these symptoms. Death which was not otherwise explained with respiratory distress preceding death, contact or probable or confirmed case linked to COVID-19 cluster. So these patients may be labeled as probable cases. Once these probable cases are confirmed with positive nucleated amplification assays or RT-PCR or through rapid antigen detection test, then these patients may be labeled as confirmed case. So at the moment, we are not seeing too many cases with bad lung. So this criteria may not be that frequently seen as it was seen in the Delta waves. So once the person tests negative, we have to observe that patient. And if the person has some symptoms of fever or shortness of breath, which is worsening, then that patient should be tested. And depending on the result, one can classify whether the patient has moderate or severe disease. This will require admission. And those with mild symptoms, they do not require usually hospitalization, and they may be advised for home isolation and management accordingly. So what are the prerequisites for home-based care? So patient should be stable enough to receive care at home. That is, patient should have mild disease. Appropriate caregivers are available at home to provide care on 24/7 basis with regular communication with a hospital or a doctor. There should be a bedroom where the patient can recover without sharing immediate space with others. That is very important. There should preferably be a separate bathroom for the patient. If this is not feasible, care should be taken to disinfect the bathroom after each use so that the other family members are safe. Resources for access to food and other necessities. So not that the patient has to go fetch all these things. Patient and other household members can adhere to precautions recommended as part of home care or isolation. So selecting a patient for home isolation is also important. So patients who have comorbidities like age more than 60 years, diabetic, hypertensive, or have other chronic illnesses like chronic liver disease, chronic kidney disease, have heart-related issues, previous stroke, lung disease, or immunocompromised patients. These patients should be advised home isolation only after proper evaluation and should not be advised just like that. So you have to take care in this specific case group of patient before asking for home isolation. So the important thing which the both patient and caregivers should know is regarding the mode of transmission of this particular virus. Of course, initially it was thought to be a droplet infection where contact transmission was of given more importance, but with as the knowledge about this transmission has improved, what has been seen that aerosol also plays an important role in the transmission of this virus. So this information should be very clear to the patient and the relatives that this transmission can happen both way. So they should ensure that they are able to reduce direct contact and distancing with the patient, They should clearly clean the surfaces, follow respiratory hygiene and etiquettes. The mask should be used, especially when the both the patient and the caregiver are coming in contact with each other. Wherever feasible, adequate ventilation, natural ventilation should be provided. Crowding and decreased time spent in crowded indoor space shared by the patient, that should be decreased. Use of mask whenever indoors in contact with the patient. And it's important that not only you wear mask, but it should fit properly and the quality of mask should be good, especially if you are dealing with somebody sick in your home. So you have to take precautions to avoid all forms of transmission. So prepare a separate room for the patient, which should be isolated and should be away from other people, and keep the room well ventilated and wherever feasible, open windows. You have to identify one household member to be the contact person who is not at high risk and has fewest contacts with people outside. Of course, if this person is taking care of the patient, then he should not be going out and mingling with other people or going to buy stuff for that particular patient. That's again important. Wear a medical mask if in the same room, preferably N95 mask. Preferably use separate dishes, cups, eating utensils, and bedding from the sick person. Clean and disinfect frequently touched surfaces of the house. You have to monitor the sick person's symptoms regularly. Pay special attention if the person is at high risk of serious illness, any patient with comorbidities, patients who are elderly. Ensure that the sick patient takes adequate rest and stays hydrated. You have to stay in communication with the treating physician and promptly report any deterioration in the symptoms of the patient. You have to continue all the medications for comorbid conditions after consulting with the doctor who have advised for home isolation. Saline gargle may help in throat congestion. If patient has throat pain or something, that can help, help along with steam inhalation. If the patient has blocked nose or the sinuses appear to be full, then they can take steam. But at the same time, we have to enforce among people that these are not preventive strategy against getting COVID-19. So these are more of symptomatic relief of the patient and not as a preventive strategy. The symptoms, the treatment is largely symptomatic, and for fever, one has to give paracetamol. If the fever is persisting in certain cases after in consultation with the physician, one can consider giving NSAIDs like naproxen. Other symptoms like running nose, sore throat, that can be treated with anti-allergic medications like cetirizine, levocetirizine. If the patient has dry cough, then they can be prescribed antitussives, depending on keeping in mind the comorbid condition of the patients, like diabetes and other things. Usually, investigations in home isolation is not required, and people should be discouraged not to go for these tests because that can again help in spreading the infection. So most of these patients will not require any sort of investigations. One of the most common cause of panic during second wave was use of a pulse oximeter. Most of the time, the patients were not able to use properly, and that created a lot of panic. So you have to guide your patients how to use a pulse oximeter, especially for females. Ask them to remove any nail polish or false nails. And since this is a winter time, it's essential that you warm your hand before taking your using your pulse oximeter, because the vasoconstriction may actually give false readings on the pulse oximeter. Make sure you have been resting for at least 5 minutes before taking your measurement. Rest your hand on your chest at heart level and hold still. Switch the pulse oximeter on and place it in on your fingers. Reading takes time to steady. That has to be basically told to the patient, and keep the pulse oximeter in place for at least a minute or longer if the reading keeps on changing. So whatever is the highest result, once the reading has not changed for 5 seconds, that is usually the correct reading. So don't try this different pulse oximeter in different fingers, because that can affect the reading as well. So you should prepare a symptom monitoring chart, and that chart should be shared with the treating physician or the physician in with whom you are in touch. And one should focus on the symptoms. What is the pulse, what is the temperature, whether the patient is feeling better or the same, or the thing is getting deterioration is seen, or the symptoms are not deteriorating further. So one should seek immediate medical attention or hospital admission if there is difficulty in breathing, there is dip in oxygen saturation, persistent pain or pressure in the chest, mental confusion or inability to arouse, especially in elderly, persisting or worsening symptoms beyond 3 to 4 days. So in case of any or any new symptoms which was not there and can have a potential to cause a life-threatening situation, those should be reported to the doctors with whom you are in touch, and they should advise you regarding hospital admission or whatever is required. So the caregivers and the patient both should practice hand hygiene properly, follow cough etiquettes, do not share personal items, and you have to keep cleaning the common touch surfaces like doorknobs. Whenever you are in touch with the patient, always use a triple layer medical mask or preferably a N95 mask. That is very important, especially when you are dealing with patients. Discard mask if wet or visibly soiled. You have to cut that mask, put in a packet, paper packet, and allow it for 72 hours before discarding it, so that whatever the virus may have accumulated on the mask, that is taken care of. Special care should be paid toward disposal of the waste, which include general solid waste, and use masks, gloves, tissues or swabs that should be discarded in, preferably should be treated as a biomedical waste and should be discarded separately in yellow bags. And in most of the colleges, MCD have facility for the same to collect the biomedical waste, especially in containment zones. So, of course, we have to follow the hand hygiene, cleanliness, that is important. If you show symptoms, isolate yourself, wear mask, seek medical advice, don't be doctor yourself. That message should go to your patients. Stay positive, avoid alarmist news. That is important for your mental well-being. Stay physically fit, exercise regularly, you eat a nutritious diet. And if you have any history of substance abuse, especially smoking sort of things, that should be stopped and avoided. One of the problems which most of us are facing is infodemic. There's a lot of misinformation about COVID on social media. So you have to encourage your patients to gather information from official site and not to spread misinformation, which is very common on social media platforms like WhatsApp regarding various treatment modalities. So you have to suggest to your patients to be a barrier and not carrier of this misinformation pandemic that is also a part of management of COVID-19. So what are the therapeutic options of COVID-19? What has changed over the last couple of months or year, I will say, because we are almost third year in the pandemic. So regarding steroid, one of the used or misused drug of second wave, we can say, but one thing is very clear beyond doubt that it has no clinical benefit whatsoever in non-critically ill patients. So for home isolation patient, it should not be prescribed because it has been shown that it causes prolonged viral shedding, prolonged hospitalization, increased mortality if used in non-critically ill patients. So this oral steroid should be avoided in home isolation patients. However, there may be a role of inhalational budesonide because of its local anti-inflammatory property in patients who have fever or cough beyond 5 days. But again, this decision has to be taken in consultation with the doctor and is not required for each and every patient who is in home isolation. So should be used judiciously. But oral steroid has no role whatsoever in home isolated patients. Ivermectin, again, another drug which was used widely in a second wave with the thought that it causes early viral clearance. However, there was no significant benefit in symptom or remission hospitalization in various studies. And the mechanism of action and other aspects were not very clear. So currently, it is not indicated except for any, say, under any clinical trial setting. It's not indicated. Remdesivir, again, another used or misused drug in second wave, but the results available at of various trial are equivocal. The last trial, which was done in early cases, it was shown that it may have role in patients in outpatient settings where for 3 days administration of remdesivir has shown to show 87% risk reduction However, there is, like I said, there are conflicting data. So at the moment, we do not recommend remdesivir in home-based settings because of drug toxicity, the problem with administration, and it should never be advised in home care setting. It should be administered only under hospital settings where indicated. Another drug which came when second wave had almost subsided in our country were monoclonal antibodies. So against Delta variant, there is a lot of literature and data where it shows that there is substantial reduction in relative risk of hospitalization. Risk beyond 10% of being hospitalized for COVID-19, they are the patients where monoclonal antibodies can be used. However, how to calculate this 10% risk factor, that is, there is no credible risk calculator for that. So it's more of a physician's perspective which decides whether the patient requires monoclonal antibody or not. So there are a lot of monoclonal antibodies available at the moment. Most of them are effective against Delta variant. However, one has to keep in mind the risk of anaphylaxis and need for admission for IV infusion. That is important. And also cost and availability are other factors. So it was recommended for Delta cases in patients who had this progression risk of more than 10%, especially in those who were unvaccinated, elderly, immunocompromised, patient with comorbid condition, should be given within 10 days of symptom onset, and the age of the patient should be more than 12 years or at least more than 40 cases. But where do we stand regarding these monoclonal antibodies as far as Omicron variants are concerned? Because of numerous mutation at receptor binding domain of Omicron, in vitro studies suggest that monoclonal antibodies except sotrovimab may be ineffective. So this COMET-ICE trial showed that there was 85% risk reduction in hospitalization and death if given, the patient were given sotrovimab. But again, this graph shows that the mutation in the binding sites denoted by the white boxes, that is almost absent in sotrovimab. So this is the only monoclonal antibody that is thought to be effective against Omicron variant. Other monoclonal antibodies may not be effective. So it's very important that other monoclonal antibodies may not be effective in Omicron variant. And areas with more than 80% circulating variant, only sotrovimab is the off-theoretical benefit. But unfortunately, this is not available in India at the moment. So as and when it is available, this may have some role in certain group of patients. New drug, molnupiravir, one of the most talked about drug currently in the country. So basically, it acts by incorporating RNA polymerase, where viral RNA polymerase, where it causes mutagenesis and leading to inhibition of propagation of the chain, and the virus is not able to propagate further, is not able to divide. So this causes lethal mutagenesis in the virus and causes inhibition of its growth. Molnupiravir is prescribed as 800 milligram twice daily for 5 days. It has to be initiated within 5 days of symptoms onset, and age should be more than 18 years. But is it as good as it is being said to be? Well, whatever published data is available, the data is not that robust to warrant it as first-line therapy in most of the cases. So what are the problems with the molnupiravir? The published literature has shown that it causes modest 30% relative risk reduction against hospitalization and death through 28 days. So it has been given EUA. Does EUA mean effective under all situations? Well, no. The use of molnupiravir is in select group of patients. Is molnupiravir is magic pill? Well, whatever evidence is available at the moment, it does not suggest anything of that sort. Should it be marketed freely by the pharma companies as over-the-counter drug for mild COVID-19, especially for the patients under home isolation? Well, whatever data is available, it should not be done that way. So what are the risks and benefits that we have to see? So since it attacks the rapidly dividing cells, so the gonadal tissue, embryo fetal toxicity, bone cartilage in young, and it has a carcinogenic potential that has been shown through the animal model studies. And that has to be taken into account if it is to be used in such a large scale. So the emergency use authorization given by US FDA clearly says that those patients who have tested positive for SARS-CoV-2, who are at high risk of progression, and in whom alternative COVID-19 treatment options authorized by FDA are not accessible or clinically appropriate, they may be considered for this particular drug. That doesn't mean anybody who has mild symptom of COVID-19 should be given or offered this particular drug. So this thing should be very clear with all the practicing doctors who are dealing with COVID-19 patients. So molnupiravir is not authorized in patients less than 18 years. For initiation of treatment in patients requiring hospitalization, again, moderate and severe patients should not be given this particular drug. Its use should not be longer than 5 consecutive days and should not be used for pre-exposure or post-exposure prophylaxis. So this drug has a very great potential of misuse, and these facts should be very clear to the prescribing doctors before writing this medicine for any patient. And this thing should be passed on the patient as well. And the most important problem at the moment is embryo fetal toxicity. So any pregnant patient or the patients who are planning to for pregnancy in near future, they should not be given. Bone and cartilage toxicity. So any patient who is less than 18 years should not be offered this particular drug. So women of childbearing potential, a reliable contraception for up to 4 days after receiving molnupiravir is important. Lactating mothers, of course, they will have to avoid breastfeeding because, there is no safety data for the same. Men of reproductive potential, reliable methods of contraception for at least 3 months after the last dose of molnupiravir, because again, it has a potential to affect the gametocytes. So again, these drugs are not as safe as it is being projected. So it has to be used carefully. So majority of cases of Omicron are mild. Majority of Omicron patients are young with reproductive potential. Approximate cost of this particular therapy is around 1400. But again, there may be issues with unregulated over-the-counter use. So this needs to be taken care of. So known and unknown risk outweighs Miagre 30% risk reduction. So it should not be used indiscriminately among all mild patients. Another drug which is not available currently but has a promise is Paxlovid, which is a combination of nirmatrelvir with ritonavir. And studies have shown a risk reduction of 88%. But again, it is not available in India, but it can have a promise once available in India. When to discontinue home isolation? Again, that's important. So the guideline released by Ministry today says that at least 7 days have passed from the onset of symptoms or date of sampling for asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic cases, and the patient should be asymptomatic for at least 3 days. No need of test of cure after home isolation period is over, and asymptomatic contacts need not undergo testing. To follow COVID-appropriate behavior, in case if these contacts develop symptoms, they should undergo RT-PCR testing. So take-home message, of course, virus is trying to evolve. At the same time, we also have to evolve so as to counter this threat. So majority of Omicron cases are expected to be mild. So home isolation and management will be a very key component of this particular wave. Home isolation, symptomatic management and monitoring to be encouraged. Most of these patients will not require any of the fancy drugs and will recover on their own. Rational treatment is the key. And of course, it's important that we do no harm to the patient. Break the chain. That is important. Social distancing, mask, hand washing, and vaccination should be encouraged in the masses. And of course, infodemic is again a very danger in this pandemic, because ignorance is not bliss anymore. And whatever information you pass on has to be verified before forwarding it to anyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Neeraj. Thank you for an excellent presentation. And I think the take-home message is very clear that Omicron is predominantly a mild illness, and therefore the treatment for most or majority, I would say, is only symptomatic. And therefore, we should not rush in prescribing fancy treatment or trying to do more harm than good. Majority of patients will improve with just symptomatic treatment. And therefore, it's important for us to really understand that we have to really reassure patients and not really go or worry about the infodemic. That is also very, very important.